You want to talk some underrated fantasy football players? Then we are here for you. It's the Audible Cecil Lammy, Sigma Bloom, and Xavier Worthy. You're not drafting him high enough. We've seen the glimpses, and oh my God, with Pat Mahomes. We won't talk about the behind-the-back pass, Bloom, because Andy Reid says it's not a big deal. Yeah. So let's talk about Xavier Worthy, because he is a big deal. And if you look at his current ADP and you look at where people are taking him, it's almost as a afterthought. Like, no, he could be much more valuable, and catching passes from Pat Mahomes, it looks beautiful, man.
Yeah, it does. And the whole offense could look beautiful because of it. But Worthy, sixth round? I think if you want him, you can almost certainly get him in the fifth round. But I think it's a very valid question if he should go ahead of Rashee Rice, even though it looks like Rice's suspension is going to happen this year. Rice gives you that high floor, and Rice could make some more noise if everything is loosened up in this offense. But hey, a 50-yard touchdown is the same as 6 for 60. That's like a whole afternoon. For one guy, it's one play for the other guy. All right. Mm-hmm. And you see Cease, Matt Walden, and other people look. Xavier Worthy isn't. Well, here's what the funny thing about fantasy football psychology. When it's the fastest guy in the draft, Cease, who's the name they always say, well, he has to be this guy for him to hit? It's always
DeSean Jackson.
DeSean Jackson. Yeah. Always. Yeah. Who was DeSean Jackson's coach when he had played his best football?
Andy Reid.
Oh, right? It's just that simple. It really is that simple sometimes. It really is that simple. And when you watch Worthy, as people say, and it's not hyperbole, the fastest receiver in the history of, it's not hyperbole to say that, but it's not just the speed. He knows how to use it. He knows how to use it to put his guy on skates. Patrick Mahomes, see, I just continue to get the feeling that this dynasty, it's good fun to go there, is on a revenge tour. They're on a revenge tour, and they just won another Super Bowl.
Yeah, on a revenge tour. And with Xavier Worthy, let me just throw out some names for you.
Yeah.
And names that we appreciate. Because right now, Xavier Worthy, in terms of like rankings, he's somewhere in the 40s, right? But that's right around a rejuvenated Brandon Cooks, I guess. Yeah. Brian Thomas is around him. Marquise Brown is right there in front of him. Ladd McConkey, who we actually have some information on of like, okay, maybe he's just the slot, even though I love his game. Tyler Lockett, although is Sam Howell going to win that job? Jaxon Smith-Njigba with the rejuvenated work ethic. Jaden Reed, of course, exciting. Calvin Ridley's well ahead of him. Keenan Allen's ahead of him. And I talked on Tuesday about how Roma Dunze is probably just going to take Keenan Allen's job. And all due respect to Keenan, but it's like Roma Dunze is the snip, snap, snap. So I just look at where Xavier Worthy's at, and I'm like, nope, higher, higher.
Yeah, yeah, as high as the fourth round. I think that you brought up Odunze, and if I'm going into a big draft this week, I have to decide who am I reserving my fifth round pick for, Odunze and or Worthy, and maybe you can get both. Maybe you can get both, because both of these guys, I think, are being vastly underestimated in terms of their ceiling, and Cease, it's because of quarterbacks in both cases that are most comfortable trying to break the back of a defense, trying to outlast a defense and do those things. You brought up the behind the back pass. Why is the behind the back pass important? Travis Kelce ran the wrong route, which is funny, actually.
Yes.
Right. I mean, it is funny, but what it shows you is, and I know it's just preseason, for Patrick Mahomes, the game happens at a different speed so that he can make decisions like that in the context of a game. The other quarterbacks, I think even the good processor quarterbacks, it's still happening way too fast. And we saw that from Caleb Williams, right? We saw Caleb Williams also in some ways deliberate, even though he was able to navigate all kinds of chaos around him to create a downfield throw to Roma Dunze, like a total dime. And I think that you're seeing this. And I think the other chemistry combination we can bring up is CJ Stroud and Tank Dell. Quarterback chemistry, quarterback wide receiver chemistry is so important in fantasy football. We don't talk about it enough. It's there with the rookies and their quarterbacks.
Yes, it's there with Greg Dortch. Like, we're trendsetters, Bloom. This is our 19th season of the Audible. So we were doing this in the before the Blog Talk Radio days. Again, I always joke the first episode of this show was literally recorded on a cassette. Many of you may not know what that is. But the trend has been there with Greg Dortch. We haven't really talked about him. So let's talk about him now. Talk about the hype. Talk about the connection with his quarterback. Right. And just talk about this offense.
Yeah. It's all positive. This is all good stuff. First of all, Greg Dortch, late round pick. I might look forward to my 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th round picks more sometimes than my first, second, third round picks. These are the players you have in your back pocket, and they have momentum, and you want to see how they come out of the gate. And I think with Greg Dortch, you have a player that the team was excited to bring back. You have a player that Marvin Harrison Jr., where's his camp hype? It's all Greg Dortch. It's all these plays that Greg Dortch is making. There's not a clear second wide receiver. Trey McBride is there too. But I think that Kyler Murray, maybe in a different context, remember, Drew Petzing made this offense look good. And we're going to have the Cliff Kingsbury experience out in Washington, separate conversation. But all these things, when we try to calculate the deltas, how much things can change positively or negatively, it's got to be a positive change for Kyler Murray, physically back and running an offense that is setting him up for success with some players around him now. Harrison, McBride, add in Dortch, James Conner, Trey Benson. This ship has gotten turned around, and there could be a lot of winners in this offense. So it makes it easy to get in one of the last rounds with Dortch.
Yeah, one of the last rounds and one of the hottest names out there, a darling in the fantasy community. And again, I'm going to give you players around him that should have no business going in front of him, based off of what he's done and what he can do in this offense. There's Tyler Boyd at wide receiver 75, because Dortch right now in rankings is wide receiver 85.
Right.
Roman Wilson's not going to play, and he's at wide receiver 86. You know, Tim Patrick, we'll put a pin in that because he certainly has a connection. There's that chemistry with Bo Nix. Marvin Mims is 10 spots ahead of him. There's no way in hell that Mims is going to catch like 20 passes this year. There's no way in hell he should be above Greg Dortch. My buddy Khalif Raymond's there. Certainly appreciate him, but Khalif shouldn't be there above Greg Dortch. Elijah Moore, I guess, but if Amari's doing his thing,
we're living in the past.
Exactly. So it's like, and the Andre Yosefis thing, which is interesting because we've talked a little bit about him. The skill is certainly there. But then when you hear the coaches talk about it, it's like, well, there's going to be a cluster of receivers with Yosefis there. So with Dortch, it's like, hell yeah, perfect late round, perfect underrated player.
Yeah, underrated players. And sometimes it's just as easy as seeing who has been getting attention for good reasons in training camp.
Yes, yep. Sometimes it's as simple as looking at your shirt, Bloom.
Yeah.
If you're watching us on YouTube, like and comment, share, subscribe. If you're listening to the Audible, thank you. Again, 19 years in on this thing. You're wearing a Lions shirt.
Yep.
So as soon as we start talking about what we're going to talk about today, you're like, Sione Vaki, Sione Vaki, Sione Vaki.
Yeah.
I was like, whoa. Give me the cliff notes, baby. So I'm just going to back up and let you pour out the love for the Utah safety / running back.
Right. Right. This is a guy that the Lions, specifically Dan Campbell, love. And they had a vision for him. He had played under 100 snaps as a running back in college, but they announced him as a running back and they developed him as a running back. And from all outward indications, they are so pleased with what he's doing. And I think that sometimes it's just as simple as kneecap biting. You know, he had a run where his face mask came off of his helmet in the game. And Dan Campbell was just marveling at it. I mean, how much more of a Dan Campbell guy can you be that you keep running when your face mask has been torn off? And we like Craig Netflix Reynolds. He's a good story. I'm happy for the success he's had in the NFL. But Vaki has so much more to offer. And what's really fascinating to me about this season, you know where this all goes, but you want to go back to the beginnings of the Audible. You want to go back. Let's talk about Brandon Marshall. Let's talk about Brandon Marshall. Because one of the things that was really exciting, and Brandon Marshall, I always tip my cap to him, and he's been, his life, dare I say his life after football, has been as interesting as his football career. So
more impactful after football.
Yeah, absolutely. With intention.
Yes.
And he played a year at safety at Central Florida. And
led him in interceptions.
Yeah, he was a good safety.
Had 7 picks that year.
Yeah, he was good. And then he went back to wide receiver in his senior year. And you could see how it changed his mentality as an offensive player. I think it was in the Hawaii Bowl when someone went to jam him. He just threw him to the ground. And that is in the red zone. That's an easy touchdown, right? But you had that defender's mentality as an offensive player. That's Vaki. That's Vaki. And I think at other points in the summer, you would say, well, he's a special teamer. He's a developmental player. He, you know, they took him in the fourth round, so they're not going to try to put him on the practice squad. But he's learning the position. Now you're hearing more of a tenor and tone that, wow, he's showing us he can be part of this football team now. Jahmyr Gibbs already has a hamstring injury. Mm-hmm. David Montgomery, we love the way he plays, but he plays without regard for his health. He misses a game or two every year, and you know, things can get worse than just a game or two sometimes. And this is one of the best offenses in the league, maybe the best offense in the league, certainly in the top three or top five. He's a potential league winner. He probably is on the waiver wire in dynasty leagues right now. So, and I'm also wearing my Via 313 hat, Via 313, coming to a city near you if you live in the West.
Nice. I like that. Sione Vaki is going behind Royce Freeman.
Yeah.
Michael Carter. Now, Denaric Prince is there. So if I had my druthers,
yeah,
I don't even know what that means, Bloom. But if it was me, like, okay, Prince, Vaki, I'd go with Prince, but that's just me.
You have anything to say about Carson Steele, by the way, Cease? Any Carson Steele take rattling around in there at all?
I mean, you had to throw in Carson Steele like that. Again, we're talking about players that are building momentum,
yeah,
and building kind of that excitement. Steele definitely a player that people are paying attention to now. For me, Payton again,
Hillis, right?
Yeah. For me, I prefer, if I'm looking at guys just around Sione Vaki right now, I'm preferring like a Denaric Prince. Uh-huh. But again, further players that are going above him in rankings or in drafts.
Oh, I mean, a ton of them. Most of them.
Yeah.
I would take him over Ezekiel Elliott. I would take him over any Cowboys running back, you know.
Yes. Where's Isaac Garendo's in here somewhere, right? Sure. I'm just looking at Chase Edmonds, who's not even, it's going to be Bucky Irving as the backup to Rashad White.
Right.
So, like, totally off the radar. It's perfect, Bloom. I love when you talk about players that you love.
It's exciting. Allen, my man Allen, pointed out, he picked up on this a week ago. He's like, Vaki's one of your guys this year. Like, yeah, he is. And it's because if you impress Dan Campbell, then you impress me.
You and Dan Campbell, man.
Yeah. Love.
You and yeah. There you go. Let's move on and let's talk about Sam Darnold and how the fit is there. Again, sometimes it's as simple. Is it Occam's razor? What's the one that's like the simplest answer?
The simplest explanation. It's where you used to start, at least.
Sam Darnold used to throw to Justin Jefferson. Everyone's ignoring Sam Darnold because he sucks or whatever. Like, again, as I've said on this show, there's a much higher opinion of Sam Darnold in the coaching world and scouting world than there is in the fantasy football community. So we're not saying QB1, but QB2 bye week filler. Yeah, Sam Darnold. And maybe it is pushing for like top 15 numbers. He gets to throw to Justin Jefferson.
Right.
And Kevin O'Connell offense that, quite frankly, and I do love JJ, even though I had a second round grade on him, JJ doesn't fit Kevin O'Connell because of the arm. Sam Darnold does.
Yeah.
So let's see.
Yeah. And Cease, one of the things this makes me want to focus on for a second is we shouldn't talk about quarterbacks. We should talk about quarterbacks and play caller, offense designer synergies, right? That's why Jared Goff matters. That's why Brock Purdy matters. They wouldn't matter on other teams. So we can talk about Sam Darnold, the Jet, Sam Darnold, the Panther. Right. Sam Darnold, the 49er, might have been interesting, but it was just a blink and it was gone. But Sam Darnold, the Viking, with Kevin O'Connell, after seeing, certainly for a fantasy point of view, where we just care about bottom line numbers, well, we've already seen Nick Mullins do that. And by the way, Nick Mullins figures in that San Francisco story too. He had a pretty wildly high yards per attempt in the Kyle Shanahan's offense to illuminate that maybe the offense just with a competent driver. And that's all you're asking Sam Darnold to do. So this J.J. McCarthy story, McCarthy, they move up one pick, they fall, whatever. This is the quarterback they really wanted, but they really wanted to trade up for Drake May. And J.J. McCarthy looked pretty good in the preseason, good enough to start to reconsider, well, when do you want J.J. McCarthy? When will he be ready to play? And then in the process of that, he gets hurt. Is this story really about Sam Darnold all along? That this is Sam Darnold's Baker Mayfield turn? where he's a starter next year. He's got a $100+ million contract. Why not? We haven't really seen him. We haven't seen him be terrible in a way that's independent of the way his situation was terrible. If I'm saying that in a way that's so. I think there's a redemption story here, and for fantasy football, especially Superflex leagues, Superflex Dynasty leagues, because of course these, what are all the wise people saying? Sell, sell, sell. Oh, Sam Darnold. People think Sam Darnold's worth something now. Well, maybe he is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and maybe you should be buying. And again, looking at his rankings and the players around him, like, all right, man. I mean, underrated as it gets for Sam Darnold, the quarterback 25. There's Baker at 23. That's slow. Geno, again, Geno's a little banged up, and Sam Howell's there. Deshaun Watson with his arm fatigue. Was it you that was saying that on Twitter? Did I see you on Twitter, X Bloom, talking about Deshaun Watson's arm fatigue?
I think, well, I mean, that's, there's a whole other side here, because I want to believe in Nick Chubb. I want to the Browns, Jim Schwartz, that defense, kind of all come together. But yeah, the vibes around Deshaun Watson, we still haven't seen him look good. But Sam Darnold may have more to offer than any of these guys.
Yeah, yeah. Jonnu Smith, to wrap up the show, because again, sometimes it's just like, hey, where's the good players on the good offenses?
Yeah.
People aren't looking at. Jonnu Smith is one of those. Now, Tyreek Hill and Jalen Waddle both should be ready for week one. I wouldn't be concerned there. There is a collection of running backs that they could turn to at any time. At any moment, but Jonnu Smith is there to make plays, to be like supercharged. We never saw Delaney Walker in an offense like this.
No. And I'm so fascinated. I'm so drawn to this. And Mike McDaniel throws gasoline on the fire when he continues to talk about the creative ways they're going to use Jonnu Smith. And we see him lining Jonnu Smith up in creative ways. And that Mike McDaniel sees what anybody who watches Jonnu Smith going all the way back to his days with the Tennessee Titans. He plays bully ball. He's a bully. And Matt Waldman has done a really great job. And the thing is, football is complicated, Cease, but it's simple. It's complicated, but it's simple. Matt Waldman has done a really good job showing how, I want to say Josh Norris maybe was showing this too, that some of the runs that Mike McDaniel creates, the running plays, look like kick returns. They look like, why? How is it so easy for Devin Achane to break one? How is it so easy? It's because of the way that the concept is simple. Maybe the execution is complicated, but the concept is simple. And when you're doing that with Jonnu Smith and you're doing it in an offense that is facing defenses that have so much breathing room because of Tyreek Hill, because of Jalen Waddle, now you have the opportunity for chunk plays on the reg from a tight end. Because, Cease, I think that you bring up Miami's offense and you want to get in. We've brought up Kansas City's offense. We've brought up Detroit's offense. These are the offenses you want to have pieces of. If a player is going to greatly exceed expectations, it's by being in an offense that greatly exceeds expectations. Both are true in Miami.
Yeah, both are true in Miami. And I love seeing Mike McDaniel look like a character from GTA.
Yeah, he's getting comfortable. South Florida. He's getting South Florida eyes.
He's getting that sun, right? Uh-huh. Right? Yeah.
Uh-huh. That's how you can tell. It's good. The Mike McDaniel story continues to be compelling. And we'll end on Mike McDaniel since we love talking about him. As I like to say, he's the closest thing to one of us becoming an NFL head coach. And what's great about that is, again, what's the origin story here? The owner didn't even want him. Owner didn't want Tua either. That's why this Tua stuff came up this week about Brian Flores saying, like, you suck, you're terrible. And Tua then having a coach saying, you're the right fit. You're good. This is going to go well. And credit to Brian Flores, who said, I look at that as I need to learn from that. Like, how can I learn from that? So that's the right answer, by the way. That's the right answer, because we all make mistakes. And especially when we have to manage people. And Tua and Mike McDaniel are writing their own story. They're writing their own story, even though there are forces, large forces around them, that didn't even want them to have that chance. And that's why I like seeing Mike McDaniel take ownership and get comfortable on his throne in Miami.
We're not to cut down day yet, and I don't think he gets cut, but I'll just throw this tidbit in there. Your next Baker Mayfield, or Sam Darnold, with another team is Zach Wilson. Speaking of guys that, like, Sean loves him. loves him. And when they announced the starter, I'm dating this show, but when they announced the starter, Sean only told the quarterbacks, and then they went to practice. There was no team meeting. Mm-hmm. And during that practice on Wednesday, as we record this on Thursday, it'll be released on Thursday, Stidham looked terrible. Bo Nix balled out, and Wilson balled out. So it's interesting when somebody supports you in what you do.
Yeah.
How does that change your outcome?
Management style. And this comes back to parenting. It's all the same thing. And absolutely, see, the other thing, we can go back to old Ryan Moats.
Oh, yes.
Louisiana
yes.
Tech. Right?
Oh, yeah. Yep, yep, yep.
Confidence, 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 confidence. And there's all kinds of life stuff we can take out of this. I'm the one that needs to take this out of this show, right? That with confidence, and confidence, let's not, we're not talking about con and con man confidence. That's a different kind of confidence. We're talking about, because, you know, it has to be genuine. It has to be authentic. But when you feel that authentic support, when you feel that authentic belief in another human being, that's how you can find it in yourself. And belief in self and confidence is a 100% necessary element in success in the NFL and in life. But in these players cannot be hitting in their top end range of outcomes unless they are feeling good and feeling like they are supported in the organization. And there are probably some players, Cease, that would respond more to abuse than support. Mm-hmm. But coaches have to be able to tell the difference.
Yeah, tell the difference and then change your style. Anyway, let's talk about retrocausality next. That's a different show, Bloom, but we will get crunchy with you later. He is
maybe it's a show
Bloom.
We already did.
It's our future self. I swear to God, it's our future self pulling us towards, like, you need to do a show on retrocausality and all that. Like, yes, it's our future selves influencing our current selves. Anyway. Go out, draft. I think we have Fessel OG coming up in about 5 days or so. So, yeah, go out, draft, kick some ass, and take some names. Joe Montana was your quarterback. Before I quote Waterboy some more, I'll just say thanks for watching us on YouTube. Support us by subscribing to all of our YouTube channels. Make sure to check out footballguys.com. Subscribe to our free daily newsletter. And if you want to support the show, we don't do any silly super chats. Just go ahead and subscribe to footballguys.com. That's how we stay employed. So thank you. We appreciate that. He's Sigmund Bloom. You follow him on Twitter, X at Sigmund Bloom. I'm at Cecil Amy saying thanks for watching and listening. Stay tuned. And would you please watch these videos? Wherever they're at. I like pointing at Bloom. He's over there. Yeah. Watch them. Watch these other videos and stay frosty.